Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. Blind, I am the RPG chick. I received a tip from somebody, sorry. I don't want to talk to him.
Yes.
I received a tip that there is something in Chilla's shrine that I missed.
Yes.
Which I'll find quite interesting. It's something that
yes,
requires a perception check, so I'm guessing I missed a perception check the first time?
Of course.
Of course we missed it, because we don't have it, right? So let us see. Interact.
All right.
A slab of pitted stone sits at the center of the shrine, heaped with a motley display of offerings, judging by the accumulated dust and filth. It's been here for decades or longer. Perception. Yeah, I don't remember seeing this. I remember seeing this and this. Search for the offering that was left by the changing god. That wasn't there before, was it? We can go 100%, so let's go 100%. You casually inspect the offerings, careful not to seem like you're planning to steal anything. Fortunately, something quickly catches your eye, the sharpened edge of a metallic device half buried under the pile. Cool. What's a Merecaster? Its unusual shape evokes a feeling of familiarity. You're certain that this was the offering left by the changing god, and you suspect that it's a Merecaster. Try to steal, quick fingers. I can only get to 70. Tyber can get to 85. It's only recently that I learned. I'm surprised even, I guess maybe I have some kind of inability in quick fingers. You wouldn't think that he could steal things, you know? We'll have him try. 85%. Success! Red tide raised a moderate amount. I almost missed that. You wait until the spec's attention briefly shifts away and then seize the device from the slab, careful not to knock any of the other offerings to the ground. The spec turns back toward you, eyes glittering, and you think you hear a faint hissing, growling noise beneath the whispers of the bloom. Even though she says nothing, you suspect that she and the bloom know what you did. Even though we got success.
I'm ready to become even more heroic!
We gotta look, XP, just forgetting that. Azure Steel Merecaster. Sweet. The device is cylindrical in shape, wrought from azure steel, with curved, sharpened projections on all sides, making it difficult to hold. It feels familiar to you, like the family heirloom that you've only heard about in stories, but always pictured in your mind. Somehow you know that it's a Merecaster. That's exactly what we just read. I wish we could drag these windows. You pissed at me? No new questions, right?
I'm
perhaps
going.
Perhaps you'll see me again. Though I can't sleep here for free, so you will not see me here again, I guess, unless some quest draws me back. Let's check out this mirror here. We are full, right? Or almost. Good enough. So depending on how long this mirror is, or if it works or not. This might be the entire episode. Possibly. You withdraw the Merecaster and hold it before you. A sour thirst immediately overtakes you. Nameless and persistent, your hands shake, your throat is dry, drier than sun-bleached stones. The pull of the mirror within this device slices like a polished shining knife through the wretched carvings clutching at your throat. Whispers rise from beneath the thirst, thoughts trapped not by the device itself, but by the maze of addiction faithfully carved within the hollows of the Merecaster. One drink, one taste will help me think. Why suffer? Why shouldn't I have what I want? I want this. I deserve this. You lift one hand from the device, and the thoughts fade into irritable muttering. Never before have we heard thoughts from a Merecaster, right? Not that I can remember. Entree? The first thing you notice is the stifling heat. The dry air feels like it's sucking the life right out of you. You stand in the middle of a crowded street. An enormous blue dome towers in the distance over crowded clay and synth steel buildings. The dome shimmers as the sunlight dances across its surface. At first I thought this was like a leg that turned into a tentacle, but no, this is... These are... I don't know. Some kind of pattern over the whole artwork here. Dark men and women jostle past you in brightly colored robes, kicking up dust clouds as they go. The dust glitters gold and silver, but it's just dust and it's making you cough. A beggar sits at your feet, her robes far grungier than those of the crowd. The beggar is a thin, gaunt young woman, her skin reddish-brown from what looks like constant sunburn, her hair bleached almost white, and her eyes green with bluish tints. The light reflects on a smooth, polished metal band around her throat. Coin for knowledge, she chants rhythmically in a pleasing voice, rocking gently. Coin for pity, coin for song. She sees you staring. I know you, she says, her normal voice almost as melodious as her chanting. She points at the side of your head. I've seen that tattoo and that uniform. You're one of the lords of the endless battle, aren't you? A cast-off? What business could you have with the Oasis? Are we at the Oasis of Emrah Jolio, I believe it is? I've heard so much about it, right? Try to remember whose life you're in now. Anamnesis. Your accoutrements. Jog your memories. His name is Rhys Folk, an officer of the 1st Militia. A patch was torn from his uniform, suggesting he is actually a former officer. He was exiled when he refused to carry out Padge's orders. Whatever it was, he was shocked that Padge would have him do it. He never did get a satisfactory answer from her as to why. Padge Reckon. He was exiled. Padge would have him do it. Have him do what? Have him tear the patch from the uniform? Or something else? Her orders. He was shocked that Padge would have him carry out these orders. And he never found out exactly why she gave him these orders. But he refused, and so he was exiled. Yeah, catching on here, guys. Several ornaments hang from your belt, a metal hand, an electronic eye, a dead power core. They're trophies. Kreese's specialty is battling constructs and automatons. These ornaments are a source of pride for him. So there's a few lies I can tell. Or I could just refuse to answer the question. Rudely. Somewhat. I guess number two isn't lying. I don't know who this person is, so I'm not gonna come right out and tell them everything, so... Number two, I was exiled. I don't know why. Her laughter is like an arpeggio played on a perfectly tuned harp. Of course you don't. I imagine whatever it is, you didn't do it either. She waves a hand back and forth. I'm sorry. Of course the details of your past are none of my business. A strange smile crosses her lips. Your exile is obvious enough from your uniform. The torn patch is a dead giveaway. I'm surprised you still wear it, but what interests me more are those curios around your belt. She points at the various trophies on your belt from defeated automatons. She beckons you closer and leans into your ear. I have a job for someone just like you. I need your help to sneak into the Oasis. Why do you need to sneak into the Oasis? First time to Emrah Jolios, I see. Yes, I have to sneak in. Oh, for a handful of shins, I can play tourist for a day, and believe me, I do, whenever I can. But I long, I need, to live there, to be a part of their waters. Her shoulders droop, but the gibbers make it difficult. They fear what blending the cultures might do, so they place heavy restrictions on who can emigrate. They patrol the borders and monitor the air skin bracelets sold in Jerboa. You must have connections or money for them to let you in. I have neither. However, she leans in eagerly, if you can avoid their patrols and breathe without a bracelet, as I can, then it is possible. I have a gibber friend who says it's more trouble than it's worth for them to seek out every illegal air breather who slips through their net. It's only the net that is the problem. So a bracelet helps you breathe the air. Or water? I guess the Oasis is water? And the... Yeah, every illegal air breather? So it looks like the bracelet helps you breathe underwater. Why do you want to get into the Oasis so badly? She sits back, folding her hands in her lap. You want a story? No, of course you don't. Here's the short, bittersweet version, then. You see this? She touches the metal band around her throat. Yes, I see it. I acquired it some time ago when I used to live in Sega's Cliffs. I can't see what compelled me to wear it, but... She laughs at her own foolishness. I did, and it gave me the most beautiful singing voice and, as an odd bonus, the ability to breathe water. I began to go by the name Tidesinger. But what blessing is without its curse? She looks wistfully in the direction of the blue dome. Mine is an overwhelming urge to immerse myself in water. I need it. I ache for it. She squeezes her fists until her knuckles become white. She lets go and sighs. I came here hoping to move into the Oasis, but their immigration laws are quite strict. I sing for money here in Jerboa, spending a day in Embrad Julios whenever I have enough scraped together. But it's not enough. I need more. Do you have a plan, then? She pats the ground next to her and waits until you're sitting down. The tour groups are our way in. The gibber guards will let anyone pass without a guide. Of course, the problem is that the guides stick to you like... She searches... Anyone pass with a guide. The guides stick to you like... She searches for the right metaphor, then lets a handful of sand sift through her fingers. Well, like dust. She raises a finger. Except at the menagerie. It's like an underwater museum, but it's so crowded that the guides simply hang out at the entrance. So we enter Emrah Jolios with a group, then slip away and hide ourselves in the menagerie until nightfall. Why do you need a group to do that? You can get lost in the crowd easier if it's just one of you. A shadow crosses her face. This is the tricky part. The menagerie is guarded by a demon, an automaton from a prior world. She playfully flicks a construct's eye hanging from your jacket. But I suspect you know a thing or two about dealing with those, don't you? With your skills, we should be able to sneak past it no problem. We slip in as tourists and wait until they take us to the menagerie. We find a place to hide until nightfall, then you take out the menagerie's demon and we disappear into the night. She catches a look on your face. You can return to Jerboa anytime you want, of course. They hardly care who leaves the Oasis. A That sounds dangerous. What's in it for me? I thought you'd never ask. She sidles closer to you. You were kicked out of the endless battle, yes? On the first side, if I'm not mistaken. She smiles at your surprise. You'd be amazed what you hear, even on the streets of Jerboa. I know a thing or two, including something very interesting about your militia. That's worth the risk. She sits back and gestures at your tattered uniform. Besides, what have you got to lose? Alright. I need a drink here. Okay. I need a little bit more of a drink. It's in for me again. Information, she whispers. Then more loudly. And the satisfaction of helping a girl in need. What could be worth more than that? Alright, I'll help you. Suppose if I refuse, the story's over. Her face lights up as bright as her song from before. Thank you. Thank you. For a man of your skills, this will be easy, I promise. Get what you need. I'll meet you at the gates in an hour. Then she gets up and practically floats away. Finding the gates of the oasis is simple. All roads radiate from the dome like a hub. The air is cool and fresh near the bubble. This close, the waters appear to rise perfectly vertically. You strain your neck trying to see where they disappear. An energy net shimmers just inside the waters, open only at a single point where several Jibra armed with barbed, glowing spears scrutinize every air breather who tries to enter. Those with bracelets and tour guides are allowed to pass. The rest are turned away. Neem suddenly slaps an air skin bracelet on your wrist. You feel a slight tingle, but nothing more. She points to a group of Jibroans next to a smiling Jibra. Ready? Let's go. So her name's Neem, or Nemi, or something. Slipping into the oasis is surprising. There's no shield or force holding the waters. You walk into them like you might walk the sea. You're just like walking into like a wall of water, I guess? Or a bubble of water? Yeah. Once inside, the tour guide takes you all over the massive city, through the sunken market, an underwater park, the government square. Hey, government square. Neem was right. She doesn't let you out of her sight once. Finally, you arrive at the menagerie. It's just as crowded as Neem said it would be, filled with creatures and curios, as though it can't decide whether it's a museum or a zoo. It's almost overwhelming, and you don't know what to look at first. Remember, Neem says, her hand gently holding your arm, why we are here. Well, we're going to explore everything we can, of course. Watch the crowd of tourists. Scores of tourists meander through the menagerie's corridors. The vast majority of them are human, but there are several Jibra and other water-breathing races as well. A soft current seems to carry them from one exhibit to the next. You can feel the pull of the current yourself, though it's trivial to resist it. One tourist hovers to one side, dressed in colorful robes, and seemingly more interested in the tourists themselves. His gaze moves back and forth across the crowds, but never on any of the exhibits themselves. Of course, he's simply doing what you are, but what is his reason for observing? Probably to make sure no one escapes. Or it slips away. Perception check. Wow. Seeing the robed tourists, you scrutinize the other tourists even more carefully, wondering if any others are observing more than just the exhibits. The robed figure appears to be the only one, but you notice something else. None of the tourists, not even the robed figure, are looking up. Even the Jibra treat the menagerie as though it were filled with air, its occupants restrained by gravity. Looking up, you notice a shadowed crevice high above, hidden behind stone structural supports. It looks just big enough for two people to hide in, if you could get there without being noticed. Well, can I examine everything? That's what I wonder. Look at everything. Examine the amulet on a pedestal in the center of the foyer. It is an amulet made of several concentric circles. A thick cord is attached to the outer circle, although it does not appear to pass through the other rings. The circles are just hovering in the center of each other. A plaque on the pedestal says it is called the Talisman of Scorgel. Myth said it belonged to the legendary Baji, believed a prophet of Nykel by the Jibra and a deity by some Jerboans. Its true origins are unknown, but it has belonged to the Giash, the ruling council of the Oasis, for several centuries. You recognize the talisman as the strange artifact from that first memory deep, deep within your mind. The changing god once needed it for something, perhaps to complete the resonance chamber itself, though all of that seems irrelevant now. Yeah, right? I don't think we can ever get back to the resonance chamber. What if I examine again? Same. Examine the dangerous-looking water creatures. The plaque calls them lorips. They are nearly twice as long as a man is tall, with two front flippers and a narrow, tooth-filled mouth. They hum an odd, dissonant tune to each other as they swim by. Oh, that tune? Neem seems entranced by it. There must be some invisible field between you and them, because they stay back from the onlookers. There's a pocket of air about 2 meters above your head. A few tourists floating there are tossing in treats they have purchased, which the lorbs snap up greedily. Their habitat resembles rocky shoals with several holes and hollows for the lorbs to hide in. The field that separates the lorbs from the tourists must not extend to the air pocket above, because the tourists are reaching right through to toss in their treats. It would be a simple thing to jump in when nobody's looking, but of course then the lorbs would likely tear you to shreds. Check out the imprisoned fire creatures. These creatures are kept in a cell of air. The ground is black, like obsidian, with glowing red nodules here and there. The air in their cell shimmers like a summer day, though you can feel no warmth from where you are. A plague says these creatures are commonly called fire whites, or flame souls, though they are made of neither fire nor spirit. The Aaron priests call them nakals. The creatures feed on water and the life force of living creatures, says the plaque. In their natural habitat, they can control and shape magma into impossible architectures. They see temperatures, not light, and so the tourists are nearly invisible to them. Despite what the plaque says, you are certain they are watching you. Same. Knuckles. Take a closer look at the construct near the door. The construct's armor is pitted and scarred, bursting with metal thorns on all sides. Instead of arms, it has long killing blades sharpened to a gleaming edge. It appears to be inactive, completely oblivious to you or anything in the menagerie. A feeling of intense loathing rises unbidden as you look upon it. These are not your feelings, you realize, but a visceral response of the person whose body you're in. Nothing new. Should I bother talking to the robed figure? I mean, I kind of want to, but that would cause unnecessary attention to us, right? He'd really be watching me then, even more than the others. So... let's wait for an opportunity, then hide in the shadowed crevice above. You point out the crevice to Neem, and she nods, understanding your intent. Wait here, she says. She swims away to a back corridor. You can no longer see her, but in a few moments a slow melody of seraphic tones floats through the water back to you. The tourists' ears perk up, and soon all of them are either looking for the sound or have swum off after it. Immediately you shove off the floor and tuck yourself away in the crevice. Neem finishes her song and thanks her onlookers. She wanders the menagerie for another 2 or 3 hours before she finds an opportunity to swim up unnoticed herself. Very patient, isn't she? Well, this is very important to her. Ooh, look at that thing. That is scary looking. Then it's just a matter of waiting for nightfall. Hours pass. Tourists and tour guides leave one by one. The guides don't seem to keep track of who they brought, acting only as chaperones for tourists who wish to return. The remainder are accompanied out at sunset. The menagerie is dark and empty. Sunlight that has been filtering in from translucent rocks in the ceiling is now gone. Only a few fish and rocks still light the gloom. You emerge from your hiding place, moving as quietly as possible. But as soon as you reach the main corridor, a metallic voice carries from the direction of the front entrance. Did you think I would not see? Would not know? You will die here tonight. You see the demon around the corner, a construct bristling with spikes and blades. It doesn't seem to have seen you yet, but it knows you are here, and it is blocking the exit. You have a beam lance bracer on your forearm, but you suddenly wonder if that will be enough. Okay, we're going to attack it with the beam lance. Yeah. I think I only have light weapon proficiency, but does that matter? Because I'm acting out someone else. You know, this is his physical form. I'm gonna bet on this is his physical ability, not mine, that we're dependent on here. Try to blind the demon with the beam link. Attack? Yeah, right. Attack, which we don't need anything for, right? Or disable it. Or blind it. Let's just attack. Who knows if blinding it will even make a difference? You take aim and blast it in the shoulder. It reels back, sparks and debris flying from it in all directions, then hovering in the water around it. It's wounded, but not enough to slow it down. Before you can react, the demon fires a blast of energy that causes the water surrounding you to burn like fire. You scream in agony. When your vision returns, Neem is still next to you, breathing heavily within her air skin bracelet. It doesn't look like she could take another hit like that. Even you could only survive a short while longer. Try to blind the demon with the beam lance. 50%? How about this one? Disable. 50%. Failure. You aim the lance at its head and fire. The beam strikes a glancing blow across the side of the thing's face, doing damage but not blinding it. It turns back and shows an inhuman grin. I was made for this. Perfectly designed to kill you. There is no chance you will survive. Oh, crap. Aw. The demon zips through the... I know, I skipped ahead to the last sentence. The demon zips through the water, its blades gleaming dangerously. You and Neem try to get out of the way, but it's too fast. It twists and spins, slashing you across the back and slicing Neem's throat through her metal collar. Two clouds of blood burst into the water. Neem is dead, and you are very close to joining her. Try to run past it. You fire your lance to its left to drive it away. It works. The demon avoids the blast, leaving a gap between you and the exit. You swim for it, but the demon appears in front of you with metallic laughter. Oh! The end. The demon fires another blast from its gun. You kick off a stone wall as the rock melts into slag. Suddenly, the demon is right in front of you, blades whirling. You try to change direction, but you are too weak. As the blade slices through your skull, you realize the demon intended for you to dodge its first blast. Its first blast? The menagerie goes black, the pain extending far too long. Finally, a new pain joins it, a wrenching in your gut that pulls you back into your own body. Oh, the first blast here of this paragraph. Well, that stunk. I wonder if I could have done something better. don't suppose none of these work the second time. Nope, there's no way to access it again. Well, stinky.
Yes, now. Yes.
Okay, so now we're going to be continuing with the main quest. Finally. My basic strategy for games is to get rid of all side quests that I can and then continue with the main, you know, whatever.
Go.
Convenient anyway. Civil War Cures, Rebel Gum stuff. So we'll be heading to the trade post next episode, guys. You know what? Here. Something about the Boredom Slayer. Increase the edge. Wait. He has edge. 2 edge and might. That's giving him edge in speed. Because we can't in intellect at all. He has crescendo. When Eretus lands a critical hit, gain +3 damage to his attacks for the rest of the crisis. Nice. This effect stacks, increasing with each critical hit. Awesome. With every powerful blow, Eretus's glow intensifies as attacks get stronger and stronger and stronger. Sweet. I can choose one ability. Hook. Thought he already had that. I guess it must be Tiber who has that then. Yes, Tiber is the one who has it. Ignore the flanked fennel. Drink to the dregs. Max effort +1 on attacks. Focus, effort, precision. These are your watchwords, and you put them into play every time you make an attack. And pinning reaction. Opportunist and counterattack attacks end the target's turn on hit. A foe can't fight if she can't move. Your opportunistic attacks shock your enemy's mind, stopping them in their tracks. I don't use these very much. Or that type anyway. Flanked Fettle. Actually, Hook is pretty useful. I'll take Hook. Ooh, we can increase... That's right, he went up a tier, so we can increase a crap load of stuff. He's using a heavy weapon. Well, let's increase that even more. That's what I check and hope he has a heavy weapon. Yep, cool. I thought he did. I'm only missing, really, some speed. So, I could run back, but I'm just gonna go forward as we are. I can always switch and have someone else. Got the berry slaps? I've got your cure, hot and dry. I can always switch to someone else maybe and have them use their speed. So thanks so much for watching, guys. Stay tuned for next episode when we enter the training post. Endure. Enduring? Go strong.